Thank you so much for visiting Lifepoint Church online. We want to let you know that if God is doing something special in your life, we would love to hear about it. You can do so by going to our stories page and sharing at visitlifepoint.org/stories. One of the reasons we're able to provide a weekly broadcast just like this is because of the generosity of people just like you. If you'd like to support our weekly broadcast, you can do so by making a donation right on our website. Thank you so much for joining us online. We look forward to hearing a great message from God's Word today.
Hey church, today we're beginning a brand new series called Running with the Giants. Throughout this series, throughout the month of June, we're going to be looking at what would the great men and women of the faith say to us if they were to come out of the stands, as Hebrew gives us this idea that there's this cloud of witnesses. If they were to come out of the stands and run one lap with us in our life, what is it they would say to us? What's the wisdom that they would offer us to help us live the life that they lived and learn from the things that they learned from? And so I know you're going to be blessed and encouraged. I want to invite you and encourage you to be here a part of every week. Unless you're on vacation, then you can join us online, but make it a point to be in the house at your campus every week of this series. I think this could be one of our favorite things we've done all year. And throughout this series, you're going to get the opportunity to hear from some of the preachers and the communicators here in the house. Tammy and I are taking a couple of Sundays to just get away, to vacation, to be with our family. And you're going to get to hear from some of our best. I'm telling you, we have some incredible talent in the house. I've been walking through every message with all the preachers that are going to be on the platform, and it is good stuff. It's amazing. You're going to be in good hands. And today, we get to hear from our very own Berchman Paul. Berchman is the worship pastor at our Fredericksburg campus and gives some leadership and direction to worship over all the church. Berch and his wife Lauren came to us a little over 4 years ago, and they've been just a gift from God to this house. They have two little boys, Jeremiah and Zion is the newest one, and it's the year of increase, so we're believing number three is going to be on the way anytime for them. But they're just a gift to this house. I couldn't be more grateful for them. Berch is my brother from another mother. And I can't wait for you to hear the word that God has put in his heart for you today. And so I want us at every campus to get up on our feet. And if you will, put your hands together and welcome Berchman Paul to the Lifepoint stage. Come on, church, make some noise.
What's up, Lifepoint? Amen. Amen. Man, have a seat at every location. Man, just so grateful that you're in the house today. Man, anybody just glad to be in the house of God this morning? What a sweet time of worship today. Man, I'm just so grateful. Hey, before I begin today, I just want to thank our pastor so much for, one, just an awesome intro. I am your brother from another mother. And I just want to say I love you, pastor, and I honor you. We have an incredible leader, don't we, church? Yeah, an incredible leader. Just so grateful for Pastor Daniel and his wife, Tammy, and what they mean to us, what they mean to our family, and what they mean to this church. You know, they lead so well. They lead in the way that they love. They lead in generosity. They lead in passion and in learning. And I'm just grateful to be part of this team underneath his leadership. So thank you, Pastor, for everything that you do for this house and for our family. And I just pray that you're getting rest right now, that you're getting to put your feet up, that you're able to get some sun on you, and you come back nice and tan, almost close to how brown I am, you know, and you're going to come back, and God's going to ignite another fire inside of you. And we miss you already. So we love you, Pastor, and we honor you. Amen. And also, you know, like this isn't my normal position on Sunday. So how about Lifepoint Worship, everybody? Can we just honor them? Man, they're the best. They're the best, man. It is so cool to be part of this team. So grateful for the men and women that make Lifepoint Worship all that it is. Grateful for you. And thank you for holding my arms up in the season as I prepare in a different way for this Sunday. Just grateful for every one of you at every campus. Love you guys. So like Pastor talked about, we're in a series called Running with the Giants over the next few weeks. And I'm just grateful to be able to look at one of these men and women in the scriptures, you know, who the Bible calls them the cloud of witnesses. You know, Hebrews 12, verse 1 says, since we're now surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses. You know, the Bible kind of gives us this impression that these men and women of the faith are watching us, that they're watching us as we're running this race of life. And what if we could just take one person, just for a moment, if they could step out of the cloud, get out of the stands, and do one lap around the track with us in the race of our life, what would they say to us? You know, what would they encourage us with? And, you know, today I have the privilege of talking to you about the life of Daniel, the life of Daniel. And I believe that if Daniel could step out of the cloud and run a lap with me, he would do more than just tell me something that I needed to hear or encourage me with the word. I believe Daniel would dare me to do something. I believe he would dare me to do this, to be different. In a world of same, I dare you to be different. I believe that's what Daniel will say to me, and I believe that's what he wants to say to each one of us. Because, man, we all are familiar with that expression, same old, same old. Are you familiar with that? You know, it's what you say when something is stuck in a rut. And maybe you've said that before about work. You know, you clock in at 9 and you clock out at 5, and you kind of feel like work is that same old, same old. You know, what used to be something that you worked out of your passion, now you're kind of just working towards a pension. You know, that work has kind of become the same old for you. You know, maybe it's that way in your dating relationship with your spouse or in your intimate relationship with your husband or wife. And, you know, date night has kind of become the same old. It's, you go to the same old restaurant and eat the same old food and you wear that those same old clothes. And it just kind of feels like, you know, is it getting a little bit mundane, a little monotonous? It kind of feels like you're in the same old, same old. You know, could it be that the way you've approached your dating relationship has gone from like this intimate, intentional relationship to this very effective regiment? You know, like maybe there's some same old in your approach in that relationship. You know, maybe you would consider your relationship with the Lord, you know, maybe you could ask yourself this question. You know, has there been a moment in your life where you have been more in love with Jesus, more hungry for his word, more desperate for his presence than you are right now. There's a good chance that maybe you're kind of stuck in some of the same old, and God might be calling you to step out of that same old. You know, what used to be this incredible relationship that was extraordinary has kind of just become very, very ordinary. You know, where are you today? You know, what are you stuck in the same old, you know, Jesus said that he came that we would have life and be fully alive. God has called you for more. You are meant for more. I kind of feel like Switchfoot's all over my head again. We were meant to, I'm not here to sing today, but you were meant for more. You were meant for more. You were meant to live fully alive, not partially alive, you know, not kind of alive, you know, not just existing or living or surviving, but you were called to be fully alive, fully alive. This is what fully alive looks like for each of us, you know. You know, wouldn't it be refreshing just to have, in the middle of all that same old, to have something different? You know, the difference in the middle of the same, it looks like this. You know, maybe it's in your occupation. You approach work with a new sense of purpose and a new sense of passion, and you step into every opportunity to go to work with a new sense of purpose for the Lord, and you work in your occupations as is unto the Lord. You know, that's different. In the middle of the same old, you can just insert some of that difference. You know, wouldn't it be refreshing to have a few people who, in the midst of all this same, a few seniors in high school, in the midst of all that senioritis, would just choose to finish strong? You know, not just check off the box or not just go through the motions and fulfill the responsibilities, but finish strong. Finish strong. You know, wouldn't it be refreshing in the middle of all this same divorce in our culture today if there were a few couples who would decide to go the distance? Wouldn't that be refreshing today? Wouldn't it just be refreshing that there'll be some young men and some young women of God and some not so young men and not so young women of God who just choose, no matter what their context is, no matter where it is, at work or at home or in your neighborhood, to dare to be different in the world of all this same? Wouldn't that be refreshing? Isn't that something that we would need in our culture? We have enough same old. We need something different. And we see that in the life of Daniel. And this is what I love about his life, is Daniel dared to be different. In every situation he found himself in, he dared. He dared to be different. And I believe that's what Daniel will say to us. So if you have a Bible, go ahead and open up to the book of Daniel. It's somewhere near the middle. If you're not accustomed or to the Bible or you're very new to it, I love using the YouVersion Bible app. And the cool thing about the YouVersion Bible app, if you can't really find where the book of the Bible is, you can just change the sorting to alphabetical, and then that's what I do. So like, you know, where's the book of Malachi? I don't know, go to M and you'll find it, and it's right there. Ain't no shame in my game. I got no problem admitting it to you. So, but I use it every day. It's on your smartphone, and it's very, very helpful. So let's kind of get a little bit of backstory on Daniel before we jump into the text here. This is what the situation that's currently going on in Daniel's life. You know, in an area called Babylon, there's a king named Nebuchadnezzar. Let's just call him Nebi for short, because Nebuchadnezzar is too long of a name to keep saying over and over and over again. So Nebi is this king in Babylon, and he goes to Jerusalem and lays siege to all of Jerusalem, and he overthrows it, and he then takes all of the best and brightest young men in Jerusalem and brings them to Babylon. And this is what happens. They are inserted into a new culture, and they learn new customs, and they eat different food, and they are taught underneath a different educational system, and they hear different music, and they're brought into this new context where everybody's doing the same thing. And here is Daniel, who is this young man, who's a Jewish man, along with some other young Jewish men. The cool thing I love about Daniel today is that, because he's a hero of the scriptures, but the story of Daniel begins when he was 15 years old. So if you're a student today and you're feeling like, man, what could God do with me? Man, actually, what can God do with you? What can the Lord do through a person who is committed to him and chasing after his heart and sold out for the Father? God can do an incredible thing. A 15-year-old got a book in the Bible. What could God do for you in this season of your life as a 15-year-old, as a 16-year-old? Come on. Don't sell short what God can do in your life because of your age. So Daniel is beginning this this journey in Babylon, and this is where we find him. In the chapter 1 in verse 8. It'll be on the screens. Let's read this. But Daniel resolved not to defile himself with the royal food and wine. And he asked the chief official for permission not to defile himself this way. Now God had caused the official to show favor and compassion to Daniel. But the official told Daniel, I'm afraid of my lord the king, who has this, that's King Nebi, by the way, who has assigned your food and drink. Why should he see you looking worse than the other young men your age? See, Daniel was working, you know, doing some physical labor and things like that, and he was looking kind of thin. The king would then have my head because of you. Daniel then said to the guard whom the chief official had appointed over Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, please test your servants for 10 days. Give us nothing but vegetables to eat and water to drink. Then compare our appearance with that of the young men who eat the royal food and treat your servants in accordance with what you see. So he agreed to this and tested them for 10 days. See, and I don't know if you're like me, but the first time I came across this scripture, you know, I started thinking to myself, okay, here we go, another vegan who thinks they're better than all of us. You know, I don't eat anything that once had a mama, you know, or once had a face, you know, whatever the case may be. But we got to look deeper into the scripture here. You got to look deeper into the scripture here because it wasn't just about food. You know, Daniel was a Jew, and the Jews were God's chosen people. And God wanted them to be different in the middle of same. You know what I'm saying? So he wanted to distinguish them amongst all the other nations and all the other people in the world. So he gave them very specific things to live by. And we see some of those rules and laws in the book of Leviticus and Deuteronomy and all throughout the Old Testament. So one of the laws that God wanted them to live by is that they wouldn't eat food that was dedicated to other gods. So that was one of the reasons why Daniel wouldn't eat the food. He had a promise and to God that he wouldn't break. So the first reason had nothing to do with his own diet or his own appetite. It had everything to do with a promise that he had made to God already. And the other reason is that Daniel realized that this was more than a food or a diet that Babylon wanted. This was kind of about indoctrination. You see, look at the text. You know, we see that Daniel is brought out of his homeland and brought to a different home, and he has new teachers, and he has new music, and probably has new clothing to wear, and all these different things, and he has a new diet that he is given. But the interesting thing is that the first thing that Daniel denies, the first thing that he rejects, is the food that he is given to eat. Why is that? Because Daniel knew that if Babylon could get him to consume or eat enough of their food, eventually they'd begin to crave the same things that Babylon craves. See, because Daniel knew this one truth, is that our hunger informs our worship. Our hunger informs our worship. So if Babylon would just have them to eat, you know, their steak or their filet mignon or their tenderloin, or all that stuff sounds real good right now, you know, or drink their wine, all these different things, then eventually Daniel and the other Jewish young men and women would be very hungry and craving all the things of Babylon, because that was the way that Babylon wanted to get into the soul and the heart of these young men by their food. So our hunger informs our worship. I would say it like this. We exalt in the highest that which we crave the deepest. We exalt in the highest that which we crave the deepest. Think about that for yourself. Like, what is the thing that is on the top shelf of your life? If you were to draw a line, I'm sure the connection would be to something that you crave really, really deep. Crave really, really deep. The way that you live, the way you behave, the choices you make come from the things that you crave the deepest. You know, we define worship, because hunger is about worship. We define worship here at Lifepoint as our heart's affection and our mind's attention fixed on Jesus, fixed on him. And it's all about what gets our time and our treasure and all of our energy. So I would ask you today, what are your eyes fixed on? You know, what is your deepest craving today? You know, if you could just say it like this, it's my mind's attention and my heart's affection fixed on, fill in the blank. What is it for you today? You know, for many of us, it's stuff. For many of us, it's stuff. You know, it's, we want it to be shiny and brand new. We want to buy it before we can afford it, put it on credit so we can ride it, drink it, eat it, wear it, all these different things. You know, is anybody there with me today? I don't know about you, but that is what the same old thing is. I mean, we've all been there where we crave what we see so much. We're indoctrinated with all this information, and we see someone driving this car or wearing that clothes or going to that place, and we're like, if only I could have it, I'll do anything I can to get it, and because I crave it so deeply, so I'll lay things down before it. You know, it's some of us, it's stuff. You know, for many of us, it's advancement. You know, it's about climbing the corporate ladder of success, and irregardless of the people that we mow down in our way. You know, I want to have that job, or I want to have that position, or I want to, my business is going to do this, or my business is going to do that. And we sometimes forget that God has called us to be content and trust in him, because he advances us. He advances us. He grows us. And listen, nothing's wrong. Nothing's wrong with advancement. Man, who doesn't want to progress in this life? I believe God's people should be the leaders in this culture and our communities, because we have Jesus at the center. Why not have Christians at the top of organizations? And why not have Christians as principals in high schools? And why not have men and women of God who are doctors and lawyers and influencers in this culture? But what are you most hungry for in your pursuit of those things? Is it status? You know, is it a certain position, or is it purpose? What are you hungry for? You know, maybe for you today, it's companionship. You know, you look around and it's the same old thing. Everybody's got a boyfriend but me. Everybody's got a girlfriend but me. You know, and here's a good question to ask yourself, or a good way to perspective to look at it, to see if you crave something to the point of worship, is what are you willing to lay before it? What are you willing to lay down before it? You know, worship is about bringing an offering. It's about bringing a sacrifice. You know, when we worship God, we say we bring a sacrifice of praise. So when Lifepoint Worship is singing in church, we're dancing and jumping and shouting. And, you know, when I'm doing it, I'm usually really, really sweaty. And, you know, and I spit a lot when I sing. And, you know, that's my sacrifice. That's my offering of praise before the Lord. You know, that's how it looks like for me in the corporate setting. You know, for some of you today, you're just enamored with the goodness of God and the favor of God and the grace of God in your life, that you bring an offering, a financial offering. You lay that down before the feet of Jesus in gratitude. You lay it down before him. Let me ask you this question today. Do you have to lay yourself down before him so he'll stay? Do you have to lay yourself down before her so she'll stay? And listen, you might be asking yourself the question, Birch, I've got to kiss a few frogs before I can meet my prince. You know, listen, kissing frogs is the same old, same old. I'm tired of hearing about people kissing frogs. You want to know what's different? Sleeping Beauty. If you could just be patient and trust in the Lord, waiting for your Prince Charming to come your way. And wait for that person to awaken you with a sweet kiss and put a ring on it. That's what's different. The same old says, I've got to kiss frogs. Kissing frogs gives you warts. You want a wart on your face? Dare to be different in a world of same. Just because everybody's doing it doesn't make it right. Doesn't make it the thing that you need to do. Because Daniel would challenge us to be different. Be different in all those areas. What are you most hungry for? What do you crave today? You know, what is it that you are exalting to the highest place because you crave it in the deepest way? Here's something that I know that Daniel recognized, because worship is about hunger. Worship is about hunger. The enemy of your soul, if he can compromise your hunger, he can compromise your worship. Think about that word compromise for a second. Let's break that down. What does compromise mean? It means for something to be broken or shattered or to be gone from a place of being stable to being unstable. When something is compromised, you know, it's shaky now. So if God can cause your hunger to be in one place this week and another place next week and in another place the week after, you know, if that can happen, if the enemy of your soul can cause your hunger to be shifting and shaking, man, your worship will shift and shake. It'll shift from God to this, from God to that, from God to this place or that person. If he can compromise your hunger, he can compromise your worship. See, Daniel knew that, but so did Jesus. I want to look at the life of Jesus and see how Jesus recognized it was all about his hunger. Let's look at Matthew chapter 4, verse 1 through 3, and we're going to jump ahead to verse 8. So verse 1 says, then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. He was hungry, like hangry kind of hungry. The tempter came to him and said, if you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread. Listen, the enemy of your soul, he's going to go after your hunger first. He's going to go after your hunger. And he's not going to go after your hunger when you're full. He's going to go after your hunger when you're hungry. And if you haven't trained your appetite to be hungry for something very, very specific, very different in this world of same, you're going to go for the first thing that's available. You're going to go for a bunch of rocks that can be turned into bread, and you're going to eat those things. But if you can tune your hunger and tune your appetite to be hungry for Jesus and his presence and his word, man, there's nothing the enemy can do against you. There's nothing he can do against you. But let's jump ahead to verse 8. Verse 8 says, again. Somebody say again. Again. That last testing won't be the last testing. That last challenge that came your way won't be the last challenge. Something that's you got to take note about the difference between Jesus. I'm going to get back to the verse in just one second. You got to understand the difference between Jesus and the enemy. See, Jesus is a gentleman. The enemy's not. See, Jesus stands at the door and he knocks and he waits. The enemy wants to kick the door in. He wants to come again and again and again, and you felt like you faced that obstacle, he's going to come again. And you thought that you had enough faith in that season, or you had the right verse in that season, he's coming again. What you got now? You've got to put yourself and plant yourself in the house of God and put yourself in front of the Word of God. Because I believe if you give yourself those things, it gives you ammunition against the schemes of the enemy. Because he's going to come again. He's going to come again. Let's go back to the verse. Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of the world and their splendor. All this I will give to you, he said, if you will bow down and worship me. Jesus said to him, away from me, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve him only. I love this because, it's about your hunger, and it starts with hunger. It starts with satisfying that maybe surface level need, but the enemy will always take you deeper into what he really wants is for you to bow down before him. And the incredible thing that I love about Daniel is that he was a foreshadowing of Jesus. Daniel foreshadows Jesus in the Old Testament to the New Testament. Check it out. Daniel is the best and brightest, and Jesus, the lion and the lamb. He's the darling of heaven. You know, Daniel taken from Jerusalem, brought into Babylon. And here's Jesus transferred from heaven into earth, born in a manger in Bethlehem. What good could come from Bethlehem? Here's Daniel, who would be tested on every front and would succeed and excel. Here's Jesus, tested by the devil himself, and he would be successful and he would succeed. And Daniel would 500 years later, Jesus would allow his hunger to be distinguished. And here's the thing of that you got to know is that Daniel gives us an incredible example, but Jesus gives us his spirit. See, Daniel gives us courage through his story, but Jesus gives us the comforter. Come on, I'm preaching better than you're responding right now. See, Daniel gives us a great lead to follow, but Jesus gives us a leader who lives inside of us. And in every season, he's with us. See, this series is about if one of the giants could step out of the cloud and walk or run a lap with us. But Jesus says there's someone who lives inside of you, child of God, who is with you in every season, in every storm, on every high and every low, through every storm and on dry land. The Holy Spirit is with you. He guides you and he leads you. His name is the Comforter. He's the Advocate. He's the one who reveals all truth to us. You have him walking with you in every season, every situation you find yourself in. How is your hunger going to be distinguished today? Our hunger should be the thing that is distinguishable between us and the world around us, a different hunger. Because when we hunger differently, we worship differently. You know, you've got some choices here because you can hunger for things that the Lord wants you to hunger for, or you can hunger for things that the community around you wants you to hunger for. You can either hunger for greater performance, or you could hunger for more of his presence. What are you going to hunger for today? What are you hungry for today? You can pursue more junk, or you can pursue more Jesus. What do you need today? What's going to fill you and fuel you today? You can pursue another one-night stand, or you can stand with the one who hung on the cross for you, for your sin and shame. Come on. Yeah. I just believe God is telling me to dare somebody to have a different hunger today. In the middle of all this same, I dare somebody to have a different hunger, to readjust your appetite, to go on some type of fast and change the thing that you're hungry for. You know the thing about fasting? It shifts our hunger from the things that we have in a most natural sense to the things of the Lord. You know, it allows us to deny the natural to appeal to the supernatural. And maybe in the things that you watch or the things that you listen to, of the things that you allow to come into your mind and to come into your heart, you need to have a fast this week. And I just believe that God wants you to have a different kind of hunger, a different kind of appetite. But you got to tune yourself to that, or you'll be hungry for all the same things. Dare to be different in a world the same. Dare to be different. The thing that I also love about Daniel, that if you if you read about his life and you read the book of Daniel, that you may overlook, because you know the incredible thing about Daniel is he's his hero and he does his great things for God. And you know, my kid loves reading about Daniel in the lion's den, and he's this man that would only bow before the Lord, and they threw him in a den of lions. And we have the Jesus storybook Bible, and it's like the lions were like little kittens purring on his lap, and it's like this Daniel, this hero, you know. And you can read the life of Daniel and overlook the fact that, you know, he was not only was he had a different kind of hunger, but it wasn't just about what he had, it was about who he had. It wasn't just about the things that he can do, it was the things he did, the people he did things with. See, Daniel had different friends. He had different friends. And, you know, I look over the life of Daniel and I see how he lived life in community and lived life with friends. All of us need that too. We need friends. And here's the challenge for us today is, you know, you just don't need the same old friends. You don't need friends who are stuck in the same old. You need the right kind of friends. The right kind of friends. And you got to ask yourself, how do I know I've got the right kind of friends? Well, let's look at the friends of Daniel. Here's the cool thing. Like we read early in the scripture, you know, about the three friends that were with Daniel. Like they are the same, of the same kind. They're different, but of the same kind. Their names were Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. That'd be the names that they were changed to in Babylonian names. And we see that Daniel goes deep with them and goes to a deeper place with them because they were the different kind of friends. So let's look at their life. You know, how do you know you have the right friends? The first thing is you need friends who will stand with you in difficult times. Friends who will stand with you in difficult times. Let's read from Daniel chapter 2, verse 17 through 19. Then Daniel returned to his house and explained the matter to his friends, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. He urged them to plead for mercy from the God of heaven concerning this mystery, so that he and his friends might not be executed with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. During the night, the mystery was revealed to Daniel in a vision. Then Daniel praised the God of heaven. So let's back up a little bit and let's talk about a little bit of the backstory of where Daniel is right now. See, King Nebi, you guys remember King Nebi? He's a dude who, you know, we all get to know. He has this crazy dream in the middle of the night one night, and he calls all the wise men and all the magicians and all of Babylon to his throne room. The reason why he does that is because the dream he has is troubling to him. He's afraid of the results of what that dream could have in his own life. So he calls all of these wise men and all these magicians in Babylon together, and he says, I need you to interpret the dream that I had. And the wise men and the magicians say, sure, no problem, king, we got you. Tell us what the dream is, and we'll interpret it. But Nebi says, no, I need you to tell me my dream and then interpret it. That's the way I know that you're going to interpret it correctly. See, because Nebi had already decided in his mind that they were going to make something up, you know, to tell him what he wanted to hear. But he needed to hear what was actually taking place. And he said, tell me what my dream is and then tell me what it means. And all the magicians and all the men in Babylon were stumped. They said, we can't do this. Who can do this? No one can do this. And again, Nebi is like, tell me what my dream is. Tell me what it means, or I'm going to kill all y'all. That's what he said. I just said y'all. I've been living in Virginia too long. Y'all. I'm going to kill all y'all. Listen, this is what he says. He literally says, if none of the wise men and none of the magicians can tell me what my dream means, I'm going to issue a decree that'll take the heads of everyone. And listen, I've been in situations where I need people to get stuff done for me, but I've never wanted to kill somebody, like at least not in the literal sense. You know what I'm saying? Like sometimes I'm like, but not in the literal sense. I'm not actually going to kill somebody. But this is where King Nebi is. So the word gets around to all of Babylon, and Daniel hears about it, and he's like, are you kidding me? Where he's going to kill everyone? Like, how can this be? Give us some more time. So that's where in that scripture, Daniel goes back to his house, and he begins to meet with his three friends. And the incredible thing about his friends that I realize is that you have to have friends who are going to be with you in difficult times. You see, here's the thing about Daniel's friends is that had it been me, I might have not been home. My phone would have been off. I would have hit the silent button. My Facebook Messenger would be turned off. I'd be away. My automatic reply on my email would say, sorry, you've reached Birch. I'll return your communication as soon as possible. Thank you. But in the time of Daniel's greatest need, his friends were there. They were there. The thing that it's interesting about that text is that you start to detect in the language that the scriptures use that Daniel, you know, this hero, this man of God, this man of faith is a little bit scared. He's a little bit scared. He's a little bit apprehensive. He's a little bit anxious. And in that moment, he needed his friends to be there for him. Here's what you need to write down. If you're going to live a life that is different, if you're going to dare to be different in a world of same, you need friends who are present when your faith is absent. See, when you're afraid and you feel like you can't do it on your own, listen, you need some friends. You need some people who are going to hold your arms up and who are going to be there for you. And you need some people who, when it's late and it's difficult and you don't know what to do, they're there. They're present when your faith is absent. That's the kind of friends that you need. That's the right friends. You know, I wrote this down in my notes, that you need friends who run to the mess, who run to the fight, and run to the tough times, not from it. You need people who run to the battle with you instead of running away and retreating. That's the kind of friends that are the right friends. The second thing that makes your friends the right friends is you need the friends who pray with you and for you. You need friends who pray with you and pray for you, you know, who hold you up, who lift you up. You need friends who are going to pray for you on the spot. See, the thing about Daniel's friends is that they were waiting for him at his house, and all Daniel needed to do was to say the word, and they got to praying on the spot. And here's the thing, God revealed a mystery to them. And not only did they pray together, but they began to worship when they received the answer to prayer. You need friends who are going to be with you. You need friends who have a lot less of this and a whole lot more of this. You know what I'm saying? You need friends who are going to pray with you and pray for you. That's the kind of friends that Daniel had. The third thing is you need friends who are not stuck in the same old, same old. And I know this seems really elementary because we're coming driving this whole thing about dare to be different and the world the same and same old, same old. But listen, how many times have you found yourself in conversation with some of your friends and it's like the same old conversation over and over again? It's the same old struggle. It's like the Twilight Zone. Haven't we had this dream before? Haven't we had this conversation before? I thought she moved on from that. I thought you were over that, but they're stuck in the same old, same old, you know, and some of you need to ask yourself, am I stuck too? But you need friends who are not stuck in the same old, same old, because in the seasons when you need them the most, the season when you need a word or you need encouragement or you need someone to support you, if they're stuck in the same old, they're going to have nothing for you but the same old. So you need someone who's not stuck. You need someone who's not stuck. You know, the last thing that I want for people, the last thing I want for anyone in this life is to be stuck in a struggle. But Jesus told us in this life, we will have trouble, right? So we're going to have trouble. We're going to have struggles. So if you've got a struggle, what if you just stop struggling with the same old thing over and over again? You know, what if you were to overcome a certain situation in one season, and then you were to go into the next thing and then find a new struggle? Like, honestly, if you're going to struggle with something, let it be something different every year. You know what I'm saying? Let it be something that you've overcome. Like, you've overcome one thing and then it's another thing. Like, you know, if it's the same old thing in the same old place and the same old struggle, and that just becomes exhausting. And you need friends who are going to fight for the things that matter most. Fight for the things that matter most. The thing that hurts my heart is when I see people who are fighting over things that don't matter, that struggle over things that don't matter, you know? But then they lay down for the things that matter most. You need some friends who are not stuck in the same old, same old. You know, perhaps, you gotta think about this, outside of your relationship with God, some of the friendships that you had can be some of the most important relationships ever. And how you select them and how you choose them can be of the utmost importance. You need some friends that are not stuck. So we ask this question every week, you know, what's God saying to you? You know, what's the Lord saying to you as he's speaking to you? And what are you going to do about it? You know, consider your hunger. You know, where's your hunger today? You know, maybe you need to do an appetite check. You know, where's your hunger? You know, what do you crave in the deepest place today? You know, maybe it's stuff. Maybe it's advancement. Maybe it's, you know, companionship. You know, we talk about worship is about our hunger, and we exalt in the highest what we crave the deepest. You know, what are you exalting to the highest place of your life? You know, for many of us, it's this. It's our kids, you know? And listen, I love my kids. I love them so much. Like, they are two of the greatest blessings that the Lord has ever given me in my entire life. But I want to raise them to be men of God who grow in their faith and give everything they have to Jesus. What kind of example am I giving to them if I lay everything at the feet of Jeremiah and Zion instead of at the feet of Jesus? How am I leading them to give their whole selves to the Lord, to follow Jesus with all they've got, to bring an offering to the feet of Jesus, if the only time they ever see an offering is brought before them? What do you crave the deepest today? What are you most hungry for? You might just need to ask yourself the question, man, what has my heart's affection and my eyes' attention? And maybe you need to shift something a little bit. You know, what about your friendships? You know, we talk about if you're going to dare to be different in a world of same, we've got to have different friends. We've got to have the right friends. You know, what are the relationships in your life that you need to move on from? That's a hard question to ask. What are the relationships that you need to move on from? That you need to move on from? Someone told me after service the 9 o'clock service, that they're going to go on Facebook and clear some friends out, you know? And I'm not just talking about just, you know, on a superficial level, but on a deep level. Because here's the thing, like, God calls us to love like Jesus loved. And if we're going to love like Jesus, we got to love the people that Jesus loved. So this is not about a Christian bubble or a holy huddle or about only going to, you know, hanging out with people who go to church. You got to love the community around you. But this is about the people who are influencers in your life, who have your ear, that get your time. Who are the people that you need to move on from? You know, who are the people that you got to erase from your newsfeed? Who are the people that you need to gain? Who are the people that you need to pursue? You know, one thing that I feel so strongly about, and for everyone, we all need a mentor in this life. And sometimes the first step for you is maybe finding some friends, but maybe you need to find a mentor who can just love you where you are and encourage you. Where are you today? Who do you need to gain? What friendships need to gain? You know, a great place to do that is in small groups. You know, and you can register for one today. I know our team in the foyers would love to help you with that. Find somebody in a red shirt. They'd love to help you with that today. So, who do you need to gain? You need to gain some friends. So where are you today? What's God saying to you? And what are you going to do about it? You know, maybe for you today, your hunger needs to shift. And maybe for you, you've had a hunger for everything but the Lord, because you don't even know what it means to be hungry for Jesus, to be hungry for his word. You know, maybe your next step today is you just need to give Jesus a try. Just give him a shot. Just give him a little taste. You know what I'm saying? You just need to give him one try. And maybe no matter wherever you are at all of our locations, you know, at the end of our service today, we're going to have our prayer team down front. Maybe your next step is you're going to walk up to one of those prayer team members and you're going to say, I want to try Jesus. I want to give him a shot. And then it would be the joy of their life to walk you through what it means to know Jesus and to experience a relationship with him. Maybe that's your next step. You know, maybe you've gotten to a place where you've been stuck in that same old, same old. You know, if you want to dare to be different in this life, you know, you got to dare to be different. You got to do something different. You know, maybe you would do this. Over the next 7 days, you know, you would take 7 minutes out of every day. Maybe the first 7 minutes of your day, last 7 minutes of the day. Take 7 minutes and give that to the Lord. 7 days for 7 minutes. What if you just listened to one worship song, read one passage of scripture, and prayed? All of us can do that. You know, and I don't care where you are today. You can be, you know, you're brand new to Jesus, or you've been walking with him for 35, 40, 50 years. 7 days, 7 minutes. What if each of us did that? It would change all of our life. Can you imagine if 3,000-4,000 people all across this region spent their morning with Jesus and spent their morning in God's presence and gave him the first fruits of their day? How would it change the community around us? How would it transform our friends, your neighbors, your coworkers? I dare you to take 7 minutes out of the next 7 days. I double dog dare you. I dare someone to do that today. It's all it takes. And maybe you need a friend. Maybe today's your day to find that. Why don't every location we just bow our heads and close our eyes as we pray, and we're going to wrap up our time, and your campus pastor will be on the platform in just a few moments. What's God saying to you? And what are you going to do about it? Lord, we thank you for your word, and we thank you for the truth and how it allows us to see a little bit more clear. And we thank you, God, for the example of Daniel. But God, we also thank you for your Holy Spirit living on the inside, who leads us in every step. God, I pray even in this moment for so many people who feel like they've got a step to take. Maybe it was a step that I mentioned, or maybe it's a step that you are impressing on their heart right now. God, I pray that they would yield to you. God, would they be obedient to you? Would they surrender in this moment to you? And I just pray, God, that you would do a miracle in their life, that you would change something, and that you would take them being stuck in a world of same to being different. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Come on, can we thank God for his word today?
Once again, thank you for joining us online. We pray that today's message inspired you to grow into a deeper relationship with Jesus. We also hope that you'll visit one of our locations in person. While it's our goal to produce an excellent online experience just for you, nothing quite compares to visiting LifePoint Church in person. For times and directions, click on the location tab at the top of the page. God bless you, and we look forward to worshiping with you right here next week.